Hello, I'm Ed Ludwig for the Doylestown Historical Society. And for the historical record, it's the early spring of 2002, and we're in Doylestown Township, 1 Pine Run Road, in the home of one of Doylestown's most celebrated citizens, the all-time sensational football coach of Central Bucks West High School, whose incredible winning record rivals or surpasses that of any major coach anywhere. Our society is delighted to present to you this interview titled, Mike Pettine, Central Bucks West coach extraordinaire. He built a football dynasty and brought great fame to our community. And he will be interviewed by Bill Eastburn, the prominent lawyer and CEO of Eastburn and Gray, who is a tremendous sports fan in his own right and a good friend and admirer of Mike Pettine. When Mike retired, Bill founded the Mike Pettine Scholarship Trust in Mike's honor to provide college tuition aid for scholar athletes. Our society's mission is to preserve and commemorate the history of Doylestown so that its persons, places, and events will long be remembered. And it's in that spirit and for that purpose that we do these interviews of persons whose recollections and observations will have lasting meaning and importance. Mike Pettine is by far the youngest of those we've interviewed, but he's packed several lifetimes of achievement into his spectacular career. We appreciate very much his doing this interview, and our many thanks to Bill Eastburn, as well as to Chris and Michelle of Television for filming and editing another fine video history for us. And now, let's blow the whistle. It's kickoff time.
Thanks, Judge Ed, for blowing the whistle on us and kicking off this, wonderful potential interview. I'm sitting here with my friend Mike Pettine, who is a legend. I mean, there's probably no coach that has a record of 326 wins, 42 losses, and 4 ties in the span of 33 years of being a head coach. Mike, legends are usually from far away, and as I understand it, you grew up about a half an hour from Doylestown, is that correct?
The legend makes me a little nervous. Most of the legends I read about have passed on, but that's a nice compliment, and I thank you. I grew up Conshohocken in a mill town along the expressway, and it was a great experience for me, and it helped develop my background.
And I understand that you were very active in sports as a young man in the high school program there?
Yeah, I was blessed with a father who loved sports, and I always could get out of work by saying I was going to go play in a pickup game. So I had his encouragement, and I played, as a lot of my buddies, three sports. The seasons did not overlap. I played football, basketball, and baseball.
Oh, oftentimes, there are towns like Denora, Pennsylvania, and others that in order to get out of town, you really got to be a great athlete. Was that true in Conshohocken?
To a degree. You know, we had Allenwood Steel, we had Lee Tires, and, if you didn't excel in athletics, then maybe you were going to work in one of the local mills. My wife tells the funny story. In between a couple of my college years, I was a trash man. My next door neighbor, he was the borough manager, and I used to cut the grass and what have you. And one of the guys that worked on the truck got hurt, and he asked me if I could fill in for a week or two. I had that for a couple summers. So it was a big motivator for me. I realized if I didn't do well with Villanova, that could be my full-time job.
I understand that you actually met your wife, Joyce, in seventh grade?
Seventh grade, Conshohocken High, grade 7 through 12. And she was on the other side of the bridge, West Conshohocken, and there's a little rival there, East Conshohocken West.
And I understand she was a cheerleader.
She was a cheerleader. So, playing football helped to a degree, but now I'm very lucky. Coach's wife, the sacrifices you have to make as a coach, it's really a family situation. So she's been with me now, going on 41 years.
And as I understand it, she's never stopped being a cheerleader.
Still a cheerleader. She has a funny habit of games. When things are going badly, she doesn't look. She's thinking, good things will happen. If she...
You have three children, six grandchildren?
Yes, I have two daughters and a son.
You had one son who played for you, is that correct?
Michael played for me. It was tough for him. Fathers tend to go overboard not to favor their sons when they're coaching them in a situation. So he had a tough go. You know, the assistant coaches will tell you when he played for me, other guys shouldn't complain because he had it tougher than anybody. But I was very proud of what he did, and he had a good career at the University of Virginia.
So I understand it at Conshohocken High School, you were a two-way halfback. Everybody played both ways in those days, correct?
Right. In those days, you know, we pretty much didn't come off the field. We had 55 in our graduating class. 22 we started out with on our team. So, the coach had to utilize every player.
So I understand it, of the 22, one got injured, so you only had 21. What'd you do to scrimmage?
We had half-line scrimmages. Funny story, we went to camp the first day of practice. A young man ran off the field into the woods up in the Redding Mountains where we went away and broke his ankle. So we were down to 21.
Now, you went to Villanova?
Yes.
In the main line?
Main line.
And they were at that point playing Division I. Pretty tough schedule,
right,
weren't they?
I remember at that time, Army, Navy, top-ranked in the country. I played against Joe Bellino, Heisman Trophy winner. I remember one game in particular, Villanova, Navy played in their new stadium. And, President Eisenhower, they flew him in to see the game. And Navy made him happy. They beat us 40-7. It was quite a rout. But it was nice to meet the president. He came in our locker room after the game.
In those days, as a freshman, you couldn't play varsity ball. Is that right?
Correct.
So you were 3 years a varsity starter?
Pretty much, on and off. But 3 year letter winner, started most of the time.
Now, at that point in time, did you have any concept that you would be a lifetime football coach?
I really love football. I was preparing to be a teacher. In the back of my mind, I figured one day I'd like to coach, but truly I had aspirations, like a lot of college players, of making the pros. And as you know, the percentage is minuscule, and I found out I was somewhat banged up my senior year, came off a pretty good junior year. So all I have from the pros are some letters that I can show my kids that there was some interest. But then I got married between my junior and senior year. Pro ball wasn't in the picture, so I had to get a job and support the family, and I moved from Villanova right out of graduation to St. Pius X, a small Catholic school in Pottstown.
Do you think getting married in between your junior and senior year had any effect on your senior career in football?
Joyce isn't around, so I can kid that she had something with my to do with my off year, but actually, like so many players, injuries and affected my play. And I wasn't that big. I was one of the skinny guys. As a matter of fact, the Villanova guys, it was a standing joke. One guy would bump into the goalpost and say, "Excuse me, Mike." My program weight was 170 pounds, but I probably weighed in more in the 150 range.
Mike, you said you went to St. Pius after Villanova.
Right.
In what capacity?
I was a social studies teacher and assistant football coach.
And what kind of money would they pay you for that job in those days? As a married man, as
right,
I understand,
right,
with a child, right?
Right, and started $4,000. And I was lucky because if you're a woman, you only got 38, since the diocese did not consider females a breadwinner, so they only got $3,800. But
I don't think we ought to deal with that issue.
No, I don't think we could get away with that today.
How long did you spend there?
3 years, three great years.
And you were an assistant the 3 years to a pretty legendary coach, right?
Jim Mick, young guy, taught me a lot. He was a bachelor, workaholic, dedicated competitor. We were a good team together. He gave me opportunities, and after 3 years, I felt for my family's sake, I wanted to look in the public school system, a little more security and pay.
So how did you end up going from St. Pius to Central Bucks West?
Actually, I turned to a recruitment company, and they sent me a lot of notices, and one was Central Bucks High School in Doylestown. And I just knew Doylestown because on 202, and I had relatives in New York, and that was the way we went. Doylestown North,
So your knowledge was really on a pass-through in an automobile.
Right. I knew it was a, you know, quaint little town, but I never forget the day I called Joyce and I said, well, we're moving to Doylestown.
What was her response?
Kind of shock. But we made the move, and it was great. You know, she loves the environment as my family. It's
great. Three of you moved, is that it? You had one child by that point?
Actually, two. Two girls, because my children are 2 years apart. So we had Linda, and then Sandy was also born in Pottstown, and Michael was born in Doylestown Hospital.
So when you moved here, you just had two girls. I guess you feared you were going to be something like Chuck Bednarik that had just five girls and no football players, right?
Right. Or, you know, we kid Mike Carey, four girls. You know, Joyce, after having the boy, she says, you got your boy, that's it. So,
when you came to Central Bucks, do you remember what you were paid?
It was more than the $4,000, of course. I think it was in the $6,000 range. In those days, I didn't think about it. I mean, the teachers weren't highly paid. I was not in the profession to make a lot of money. And I thought, you know, we were doing well. But now that I look back, it's how did you survive on that type of income?
And you did survive.
We did. We had a happy life and did pretty well.
Now, you, when you moved here, you actually lived in a home that ultimately became the Central Bucks East District,
right?
Is that right?
We moved to Maplewood Community, which is in the borough proper. Well, I guess a little on the outskirts, but technically part of Doylestown Borough. And eventually, when they built Central Bucks East, I found myself in East Territory.
Coaching at West. Kids
so
going to East,
it
right?
It was a difficult situation. My older daughter had 1 year at CB East. I knew my son coming along was going to be a pretty good athlete. I knew it would be tough for me to coach him, tough for me, tough for him, but I thought it would be tougher if he played for an opponent. So, and the girls wanted to make the move. Linda, I think I recounted to you that 1 year she was over there, she took a ribbing. Her father was the coach at West, but we made the move, and we've been here, and very pleased, and all my kids are CB West graduates.
In fact, your daughter actually had a course with the Central Bucks East coach.
Chuck Racone, excellent coach, competitor, and in getting psyched up for the Thanksgiving game, he was recounting some things to her about our team better get ready. He was just making my daughter Linda very nervous. You know, she wanted no parts of you know, the intimidation.
Now, why did you never aspire or go into college ball? I mean, there's a lot more money as a coach in college, right, isn't there?
Well, early on, I saw some of my players getting recruited. I knew that was a big aspect of the college game. The guys would come in and they'd say, boy, I've been on the road for 2 or 3 weeks. I haven't seen my family. And that didn't appeal to me. I think some of those college recruiters, in order to be successful, you know, you have to be high pressure. The last week of recruiting, when it comes down to the nitty-gritty, are you going to get a recruit, you're going to lose them. Some of the nicer guys I've seen, you know, resorted to mudslinging campaigns. I never wanted to get into that situation. I think high school football was more pure coaching. The other thing with my personality, during the football season, I get so engrossed in it. You can ask my wife. She'll ask me a question. My mind will be somewhere else. I don't know if I would have fared well to be a year-round where, you know, the college game, you have your season, you have recruiting, you have spring practice, you have your summer preparation, and it can be a vicious cycle. I really respect the guys that have the personality. It can keep things in balance. I don't know whether if I could have kept things in balance. I think being a social studies teacher gave me a healthy perspective. I was away from coaching at least part of the year in football. I saw that it's a big world out there, teaching global issues, world cultures, and football was only a small part of it. So I think, as I said, for my personality, it was best that I stayed in high school. But I have to admit that there are some of those great games you see on Saturday with 100,000 people, Michigan, Penn State playing, and you wonder what it would be like to be part of that.
My understanding is that you even attempted to run your family like you did the team. Is that right?
Well, my wife would only have it to a certain point. She would put me in my place. But if you talk to my daughters and my son, they thought that I was a little too much on the discipline end. And, you know, my two girls, they were cheerleaders. They thought, you know, I paid a little too much attention to Michael. Of course, I related more with the sports end of it, always in the backyard. So And they also, the other thing they put on me was that it was tough for them to get a date, that most of the kids that would normally have dated them either had me in class or on the football team. So a lot of the boyfriends came from the Central Bucks East part of town.
In reflecting back, how would you define, in your sphere of thought pattern, the word coach?
I think coaching is teaching. I think, you know, you're so much into your sport, but when you look at the responsibility you have, just as I say, a coach is a teacher. You know, parents want their kids to be just more than successful at the game. They're mainly looking for their kids to mature, to learn those values that you often don't get in the academic classroom environment. You know, budgeting your time, teamwork, the discipline, which is so important, learning to deal with adversity. And, you know, and as a coach, my job, I felt, was, you know, everyone has a potential. I had to identify that and try to get every kid to do his best.
Mike, reflecting back, what was Doylestown like when you first arrived here in the mid-60s?
Well, actually, Doylestown proper, I don't think it's changed that much. The outskirts have grown tremendously. What used to be open farmland now, you know, quite developed. As evidenced by, you know, we needed a CB South, actually East first, and now we're waiting in 2004 for CB South. So the growth has been tremendous.
So you saw a lot of farmland outside.
I saw a lot of farmland, you know, and we used to be called the Farmers. I remember we played Westchester Henderson, big game in Westchester Stadium, and as our kids were going in, everybody was heckling us, they're kind of the farmers, and my guys are turning to me, we're not farmers, you know.
How many farmers did you ever have?
Just very few early on, and but that tag stayed with us for quite a while.
Do you have three or four players over the course of your coaching 33 years that really stand out in your mind?
Three or four, I don't like to get into it because you don't do justice. I think we've had something like 60 or 70 Division I players to play on that level. You know, you have to be a great football player.
But either as characters or
well,
justice.
As characters. In my first year, I was blessed with some outstanding talent, leadership. Doug Schobert played at Temple. The Carey brothers early on in the mid-70s. Frank Case, the most gifted natural lineman we've ever had.
You and I were very involved with Frank Case.
Right, right.
We have some funny stories about that, don't we?
Frank had an up-and-down career at Penn State, ended up on a positive note, and needed a little friendly push along the way, which you and some other people pointed him in the right direction.
And he ended up in the pros playing for Kansas City.
Actually, right. And he was one of our pro players.
And then ended up with a Liberty Bell and the
fledgling
leg.
Right.
Do you ever forget the story about when Frank announced that he wasn't going to do the run that Joe Paterno required at Penn State and was going to give up his scholarship?
Right. Well, Frank, he loved to play but didn't like the preparation to play. So the story, as you well remember, Joe had him run a mile and Frank got off the track and ducked in under the stadium to get out of it. But I guess Joe or one of the assistants caught him, so he got in a little trouble over that.
Then we had a meeting here.
We had a meeting. Yeah, I can remember trying to train him with our players to make his mile time. And after some good advice from you and a few other people, he got back up there and got over his hurdle and did well. And over in the CB West football office, there's a picture of Frank I'm proud of, and he's holding the trophy for most valuable player in the Fiesta Bowl. And now he is an elementary school teacher, doing a great job, and a football coach.
And married to a doctor. Do you have any concept of how much scholarship money is going to your scholar athletes that have played for you?
Well, no one's ever taken an accurate count, but when you look in the early days where a scholarship over 4 years might have been worth $50,000 or $60,000, and today, well, worth over $100,000. And if you look at how many people got full scholarships or partial scholarships, we're talking anywhere from, you know, $3 to $6 million. And then also, and we're proud of a lot of kids went to Ivy League where they don't go and give scholarships. We're good students, but as you know, the competition is such, And coming from a good program and having been a good player, it opened some doors for them. And that's what I always felt. You know, high school ball is kind of small time in a way, and if we can use our program as a stepping stone for bigger and better things. And this was part of the gratification I got as a coach, to see our kids go on and do well in the next level.
You made a very good point about the fact that young men that are in a football program give up a great deal during their high school career.
Right.
They don't probably can't work during the school year,
right.
And financially it can be a burden to some of their families. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely. When you take a look, especially today's athlete, you know, where you have in swimming and soccer and football and basketball, year-round demands. And the kids today are often asked to help save for their college education if they want a car, insurance, to get a job. So many of the athletes don't have that opportunity. You can't have it both ways.
So the scholarship program is really fair. It sort of balances the equities, doesn't it?
Yeah, you like to see that. And unfortunately, on a given team, not everybody's going to get that scholarship opportunity. But, you know, whether it's $500 or a full scholarship, you know, every little bit helps. And oftentimes kids will go and they'll earn a scholarship through a competition. And, of course, now it's just opened up where the girls are getting scholarships. And but any coach will tell you that's one of the nice things of the job. And we work these kids hard. They give up so much. So if they can get a reward out of that. And, of course, the scholarship fund that you helped start, and I'm indebted to you and the other trustees, means a lot to me, and it goes to student-athletes that are deserving. And I think the standards are based on some of the things that we try to teach in our program over the years. Teamwork, dedication, scholarship, and it's been one of the nicest things that ever happened. And as I say, I'm happy that I'm around to have given that award out the first couple years. And what, over $70,000 has been raised, and as I said, I'm honored and flattered that people would come forward and honor the things I try to stand for in my career to help out student athletes.
For approximately 3 years, we've awarded a scholarship to a male and female scholar athlete, and frankly, I hope you're around for a lot of years to
make
that award. Mike, there were at least two occasions in your career where you were put in a very difficult labor situation where you actually crossed two picket lines, is that correct, in strikes?
Right.
You want to talk about that, because I think that was pretty traumatizing, wasn't it?
Yeah, at the time. You know, any time you're going to go against your fellow union members. But I had a dilemma in that on one hand, I had my colleagues and what they wanted me to do, and I had to look in the eyes of my high school players that I had preached to them about dedication, commitment, loyalty, hanging together. And a lot of people don't realize if you're a teacher and you're not in sports, the commitment that these kids give. And as you know, a strike during the fall season ends up hurting pretty much the fall sports people, because the school days are made up. The other sports teams in the winter and spring seasons don't miss anything. But sometimes a senior could have his senior year ruined for his fall sport. And not only the memories, the opportunity, the chance to grow in what he likes to do, but then you have sometimes scholarship opportunities.
That could be lost in a strike.
They could be lost. So
in your crossing the picket lines on at least two strikes, did you get repercussion from your teaching colleagues?
There were some. Most of them realized that you know, how much work and time and effort. My good friends stayed, you know, encouraging me, but there were some nasty letters. There were some, you know, kind of indirect threats, and there were some people over the years that didn't talk to me.
Never talked to me,
but I must emphasize, the overwhelming majority of the faculty you know, looked at me as saying, okay, we know where he's coming from, and this was something he had to do, and kind of welcomed me back.
There are always some humor and some unique situations in sports, and you and I have been talking about
right.
Two or three of those situations where there They're almost learning experiences. You told me one about Jeff Stemple, and maybe you'd relate that interesting story.
Well, Jeff was one of the best athletes we've ever had to come through the program, and he was always very much concerned with how he dressed, the shoes he had on, you know, how the helmet looked. And he actually had a situation in college where Wayne Harden, the great coach from Temple, he was bugging Wayne about wanting a certain pair of flashy white shoes.
And it, to you know, play in the games?
To you know, wear in the games for the team. And I understand from other teammates, you know, Wayne was getting kind of irritated about, you know, it's not that important what kind of shoes you wear. Just worry about being a good football player. Well, in the middle of this big college game, the story's recounted to me that an opponent got knocked out of bounds, and Jeff was an offensive guy and happened to be standing by the coach, wasn't in the game at the time. And he went over and he elbowed Coach Harden. He said, "Coach, Coach, look at his shoes. That's what I'm talking about. Those are the shoes I want and the team wants."
What did Harden say to
him? I won't recount what Harden said to him.
This is not an X-rated film, so we better not do that, right?
True.
Tell us about the famous clipboard story.
Well, in the old days, for you know, dramatic effect, every now and then, you know, you might crack a clipboard on a player's helmet. It was harmless; it would make a lot of noise, and clipboards easily split. And it was one time in practice where things weren't going well, and I was standing next to the nicest kid on the team, Barry Snyder, and I reached my frustration point. I hit him with a clipboard, and actually, as soon as the clipboard broke, I realized, what have I done? Here's the nicest kid on the team. And I just felt so bad. And I got off the field and I kept saying, I have to apologize to him, which I did not. Time went by, and about 3 or 4 days later, I'm walking down the hall and here comes Barry in the distance. And the thought's occurring to me, I got to apologize to him. You know, of all the kids to do that, and I knew he kind of felt bad and he seemed hurt when it happened. So as I got closer to him, he came up and he said, "Coach, you know, I've been feeling really bad ever since I made you break the clipboard. And in shop class, here's a brand new clipboard I made for you." You know, there wasn't a hole big enough for me to crawl into.
That was a learning experience.
A learning experience for me.
A group of us started the North-South All-Star Football Game, originally run by the Cancer Society,
right,
and later the Lions.
Right.
And I remember first year you were the coach, you couldn't
right.
coach 2 years in a row, so second year you were trainer, right?
I was a trainer.
And somebody came up and asked for some assistance as trainer, and you looked at him like, what are you talking
right,
to me for?
Right, right. Well, the North coach, Frank Prush, he wanted another coach on the staff, and so I came in posing as a trainer. Well, obviously I didn't go over too big, and it's the last time that's ever happened. But.
And then there's a famous North-South trophy story, and I think the remnants of that
right,
trophy
right.
is in my
well,
hand.
It was, I can laugh at this. It was an embarrassing moment here. I had a lot of great memories in the All-Star game, coached a few times. And after one game in particular at William Tenet, and I was head coach of the North team, and we had a great victory. And after the game, I had borrowed some equipment from CB West and had to take it back in my station wagon. And the Lions president, he said, "Look, take the trophy. It gets circulated. It's going to go in the office of Central Bucks West." I didn't want to take it, but I took it out. And as I was loading stuff into the station wagon, I put this on the roof rack and pulled away and forgot it was there. And I remember William Tenet had some speed bumps, and I heard a little rattling. But when I got out on Street Road and I started to go, you know, 35, 40, there was this god-awful noise. It sounded like every tire when the car is coming off. And then in my rearview mirror, I saw this flash of something come off the roof and splatter, and when it hit, it had occurred to me what it was.
The trophy. And there it be.
And
right?
there it is. It's worth hundreds of dollars. Fortunately, the guy that made this, the original, took it and gave me a duplicate, but he returned this to me, put it back together, and he gave me the original plaque, and it says, "This is the one I fumbled."
It's a little bit of a humbling
right,
experience,
well, isn't it? And when word got out that happened, needless to say, I'm still getting abused over that particular incident.
You had 300 and 26 wins.
Right.
There must have been some memorable teams that you coached during that winning
right.
period. Can you reflect on some of those teams, the teams, what years they were, and some of the significance of those teams?
Well, my first team, I thought I knew a lot about coaching, and I did not. And fortunately, I was blessed with a great group of kids. The captain, when I got the job in 67, came to me and said, Coach, we're going to win them all for you. And we went undefeated. We did tie one game. Things went downhill after that. The second year had some losses, and then began to realize there's more to coaching than I thought. So you live and learn. The early 70s, we had a couple good teams. After the split, we had 2 years undefeated. Pat Carey was a quarterback of one. That team in 75 was pretty good. Jim Jensen, the quarterback. Bobby Ventresca, of course, Jim Jensen was the young man from our program who spent 11 years in the pros with the Miami Dolphins. The 78 team was awesome. For the most part, those guys were out of the game by halftime. They had such leads. Then you get into the 80s. We were on a 50-some game winning streak. The late 80s, we had some good clubs. But that 78 team was the one that stands out with pure talent that never had a chance to showcase what they could do in a championship state playoff format. The 91 team is so important because we always wondered if we could match up with the guys from Western PA. I mean, that was the mecca of football. We had some mythical championships with people from throughout the state always pretty much alluded to the idea that you could never stay on the field with these guys from Western PA. So in 91, here was our chance. We got on the field with Erie Prep, the best team in the West, and we had our first state championship. And what that did for our program, it validated all those other teams that were highly ranked and never got get an opportunity to show how good they were. So that team was very special.
That was out in Altoona, wasn't it?
That was in Altoona.
Some pretty bad weather.
And then, people ask what your proudest moments in coaching. And one of my proudest moments was not in victory, but was in defeat. Because the 93 team, in which we lost the game, we never thought we would go that far, the state final. We're playing North Hills, ranked number one in the country by USA Today. We totally outplayed that team. A kid by the name of Arrington had a great career for Penn State and now with the Redskins played. And I met him at the Maxwell Awards, and he admitted that CB West totally outplayed North Hills. But we lost 15-14 in a heartbreaker. But the effort those kids gave that day, I'll never forget. And as I said, in defeat, I was as proud of that team as any team that ever had a victory for us. And then, of course, the
run. Did you feel the agony of defeat in that game, in games like that?
There was nothing worse than the agony of that game because I'll never forget there was a press conference and we had to go to this area where we had 15, 20 press members and we had to show up about 15 minutes after. And I had every kid, there wasn't a dry eye in the locker room. And I said, guys, victory and defeat, we have to handle this with class. I said, I'm going to this press conference. I'd like some of you to come with me. And it looked like no one was going to come. But when I got out of that locker room, a couple of the captains, key players came down, and it was the toughest thing they ever had to do. And then the reporter, I would like to strangle him. The first question he asked one of our guys, how does it feel, to lose? But they handled it well. As I said, it was part of how they handled it that made me proud. And then our championship teams in the 97, 98, and 99 to win three state titles in the big school division was really special.
That's virtually unheard of in the country, isn't it?
There are some high school teams that have done this, but in Pennsylvania, as far as 4A, the big school classification, no one has won more than one.
Could you analyze how that happened in terms of Doylestown and the greater community and their involvement with you and the team and the winning streaks?
Well, I just think we had a lot of families that wanted their kids to grow up balanced and do good in school and get involved in sports. And we had a couple good feeder programs. Our junior highs did a nice job for us. We had good, solid talent. I don't think we had super talent, but I think the key after all these ingredients is that you put them in the system, and our first motto was hard work wins. You know, there are no shortcuts. And then I think after that, I think as a coach, you have to have a system that adapts to the talent and skills that you have. Some years, you know, people said we didn't throw the ball much, but hey, when we had a quarterback that could air it out, well, we threw a lot. And then other years, we were more or less 3 yards in a cloud of dust. Tradition is a big thing. I mean, kids grew up knowing, hey, as a 10th grader, I'm going to have to be committed. I'm going to have to start in the weight room. And the other thing that helped us, I think our kids developed a healthy fear of failure. The yardstick of excellence was so high. I remember a team my son played on. They were 9-2, second place finished, overachieved. Their two losses by were 1 point each. They look back on their season as kind of disappointment. Those guys never really bring up that 9-2 season that other programs might kill for. But I mean, that's one of the unfortunate aspects of success.
What do you think success did in the long range for many of your players in terms of their afterlife, after football?
Well, when you're coaching them, sometimes you ask yourself, hey, am I driving them too hard? Where are they going to get out of this? And I can tell you as a coach, it's been very fulfilling to have kids come back. Some have played football, some have not, and indicate that how many times lessons they learned, their experiences going through the program, have enabled them to overcome crises, get over hurdles, principles they've applied about dealing with disappointment, working together as a team. And a lot of times I'll meet former players at weddings and reunions, and it's great to have that feedback. And that's, I think, you're going to measure a program. We've often been criticized anytime you're successful that we've worked the kids too hard, we've taken shortcuts, we've been accused of giving kids steroids, actively recruiting. And I say, if you want to evaluate our program, the best testimony is talk to the kids who've been through the program and their parents and have them reflect some years afterwards. Because, you know, as with my father, at the time I thought he was too tough on me, but as I got into my 20s and 30s and look back, the wisdom he had and the way he pointed me in certain directions, and I think as with your teachers and coaches, sometimes you can better appreciate what they were trying to do for you when you're further removed from the situation. So I said, we've gotten very positive feedback, and I'm proud of what many of our players have done and in the community and their careers.
So there's some real lessons in life on the field. Is that what
life's lessons? And there's no question about it. You can get through athletics, and not only football. You know, other coaches can basically recount the same story.
People have tried to analyze for years why there's been the disparaging difference in the winning record of East versus West.
Right.
And maybe you could go back to the genesis of the East program and sort of analyze that for us.
Well, I always thought it was unfortunate that the first year of the split, CB East and West, they took the senior class and they just divided it. Many new schools start with sophomores and juniors. They play a JV schedule. So that first year, it hurt both East and West as far as the talent pool. And then unfortunately for East, they had a series of injuries that ended up really hampering their progress. They lost their first 27 games. So an East football tradition got off to a bad start, whereas we were having more success. We basically evolved from the old Central Bucks. We still had that continuity and the roots with the program. So again, I can't emphasize tradition. You can have tradition favor you and tradition work against you. And I think it took a long time for East to get over that tough start. And it's been tough for them. It's been a healthy rivalry, but there have been some times where, you know, from the other side of the district, they look over, and it's tough for them because they develop a program that has become pretty good, and of course, most of the recognition has come from their sister school. But I always said that rivalry has been great, and a lot of my friends are former East players and some of the East coaches. So I think it's great for the community. I mean, on Thanksgiving Day on ESPN, that rivalry was featured more than a couple of times. It's one of the great rivalries in the country.
If you were to write a book on the keys to winning, what would be the major principles you would set forth?
Well, there's preparation. Players have to prepare. I think you have to be extremely disciplined. You have to have a smart plan, which a lot of it is going to pay attention to detail. I think you have to have, along with certainly a good talent pool, I've had excellent assistant coaches. Mike Carey became a head coach and took over a year for me and did a great job. Sid Huntsberger, just to mention a few. And I think the players really have to buy into, because you get right down to it, the players, they play the game, they make the plays. Leadership is key. We've had great captains, and I've always told our players, hey, these captains are like the assistant coaches. When you think of 70, 80 guys on your team, you know, the coaches aren't going to be always the best natural leaders. So we've always cultured and fostered leadership, and I've had some great ones over the years, and that's been a big part of our success.
How important is fundamentals and teaching them?
Fundamentals, as far as the game of football, blocking, tackling. Sometimes as a coach, you get caught up in the chess game, the X's and O's, and sometimes you don't do well, and then you analyze your game film and you find out, hey, little things like blocking and tackling, you've neglected. So anytime we've struggled, it's interesting how you always evolve back to those basic drills and fundamentals.
Principal once said that each class in a high school has its own character and personality.
Right.
And also the same principal said that your teams over the years and your players helped to set an extremely positive tone in the Central Bucks West building. Do you want to comment on whether you concur with that statement?
Yeah, I'm a little bit biased, but I concur. And a principal told me one time that a successful football season set a positive tone for the entire school year. You know, it's a major sport, and let's face it, when you look at attendance, it's pretty much the main sport. But I think that only goes if the faculty and the rest of the student body respects the players. And we've always told our players, we want you to be positive role models within the school. Don't act like you're something special because you're on a winning football team. And I want to hear positive feedback from your teachers about your academics and about the fact that you're a gentleman. Now, they always haven't listened, but I can truly say over the years that how many nice compliments I've gotten about our players having nothing to do with football as the kind of kids you like representing your program.
You have had a few kids get out of sync, haven't you?
Absolutely.
What do you normally do when you see that happening? What do you do personally?
Well, it depends on the degree. I mean, in season, there are strict rules. Even out of season, if I have a captain, I tell the captains it's a year-round situation. So there have been guys we have stripped their captaincy in the off season. But we have everything from physical discipline to kids being suspended from games to youngsters unfortunately being expelled from the team. And the one thing, my philosophy is always to be fair, firm, and compassionate. Each case is a little bit different. You know, I think you have certain rules and a common denominator, but there are certain personalities you may want to treat differently when you look at some of the backgrounds. In my later years of coaching, I mean, with the breakdown of the family, some of these kids I didn't realize are coming from situations where how could they concentrate on schoolwork or coaching when I found out some of the problems they were having at home. So I think in this situation, you're a little more compassionate. You work with individuals like that.
Did you realize in some of those instances you were actually being thrust into the father figure?
Yeah, with a lot of single-parent families now, out there in society, and a lot of times, an absentee father, I had mothers come up and say, I can't do anything with them. See what you can do with them. It's a responsibility, and it's one that you enjoy, because if you can help a young man, and as I said, You like to win football games, but you can't put a price tag on the satisfaction you get from seeing a kid, you know, grow in your program, you know, a boy becoming a man, especially kids who have a reputation in ninth grade, maybe 10th grade, as troublemakers. And to have their parents or the teachers say, boy, football really helped this kid get straightened out.
You have six grandchildren. Two of them are boys, right?
Two are boys.
How do you feel about them playing football?
Well, 20 years ago, I would say it's really important for me that they play. And now I've matured and getting wiser. Whatever their talents are, develop. You know, if they're football players and good athletes, I would enjoy that. If they're going to be musicians and artists, that would make me happy too. But I think each person has to find his particular talents and then nurture them and have them channeled.
Do you think the game has changed in some measure because of the media influence?
Yeah, that's one of the negative aspects. You know, you got to thank the media for giving us great coverage. I mean, you look at some of the recognition that we've received in the other sports. But I think there's a new breed of media people, and it doesn't, I don't want to throw a blanket over all of them, but, you know, 20, 30 years ago, the average reporter looked at high school coverage as, hey, these kids are in high school. They're not getting paid, they're not professionals, and really emphasize the positive. I think today what you're seeing in a lot of circles is that some of the people who cover high school sports look at it almost like they're working in a big city, you know, Daily News Inquirer atmosphere, and look for controversy, look for the sensational aspects. For instance, a kid makes a mistake and drops an interception or fumbles and should never have his name, I think, mentioned in the paper. But these are some of the things that, you know, philosophies have changed, sometimes for the better and sometimes for the worse.
Did you ever believe that you were going to spend your entire career as a high school coach in Doylestown, Pennsylvania?
I never thought about it, but one year led to another and another. There we go, 30-some years. But we really like the community. It's a great place to, for a family to, you know, to raise children. I figured, hey, there's either big-time high school football or if I wanted to go in the college arena. And I felt the competition, the league we're in, the Bucksmont, and later on Suburban Power 10, there was nothing more exciting. The school district, the community, you know, was just very positive. And I'm glad if I had to do it over again, I would do the same thing. And as I mentioned before, I think coaching in high school, there's more pure coaching. You know, think about it. At what stage of a youngster's life could you have more of an impact? High school, hey, when they get to college, how much contact do you have with them? And then in the professional level, as a personality, their character is pretty well set.
You just made a comment, if you had to do it over. Mike, if you had to do it over, would you change in your philosophy or the way you managed young men?
Yeah, I think when I look back at my coaching style, you know, the discipline, you know, the taskmaster, the drill instructor approach, and sometimes that's necessary to get kids to do their best. I mean, you have a team of 70 or 80, you know, how many are self-motivated? But later on in my coaching career and the little time I spent with an assistant, it's really more enjoyable if a player performs well and he's the impetus of his improving. You know, So I think I would try to be more the psychologist to get kids to be self-motivated. And it's a lot more fun and more pleasurable. But not that I wouldn't still have to get the whip out, but because when I look back as an athlete, you know, those are some of the things that motivated me.
But in reality, you made a comment some time ago that you've got to be your own person.
Right.
And you can't be a phony in your own skin.
Right, this is true. A lot of times, you know, people will look with a Lombardi or Parcells or, you know, Coach Landry, for, you know, the famous coach for the Cowboys who was so laid back and had a different approach. And I think that you can learn and adapt some things from other coaches, but it has to be within the context and framework of your basic personality. You can't change that much. you know, kids recognize a phony approach in a minute. So you have to be your own guy.
Could you pick out your proudest moment in your coaching career? Is there such a thing?
I think the, as I alluded to earlier, the 91 team, when they won that state championship, they won that for all the kids that ever played Central Bucks West football. That was very special. I mentioned also, again, in defeat was a proud moment, the 93 game where in defeat our kids played their hearts out. Then there was the miraculous divine intervention game in 99.
I was there, and that is exactly
when,
the way it should be described.
We were down to our fourth team running back, and I can't tell you how many people took credit for that game afterwards. A sister was holding a good luck angel. People praying to various saints. And I said, whoever wants to take credit. But there appeared to be, if ever you know, God would take an interest in a football game, it seemed that there was, after the game, I was quoted going off the field, and I said that there was a force involved in this game that I don't entirely understand.
I was sitting in the stands, and there were three people sitting around me, and they didn't even want to look near the end. And I said, this isn't over till it's over.
Well, the hero of that game, and there couldn't have been a better hero, Andrew Elsing. And, you know, people look at the type of kid you really love to coach. I mean, here's a young man that had a paper route on weekends. We talked about how tough it was to work, and just a very active member of his church, and just a great, great kid. And for him to be the hero of that game, to me, it was just very fitting.
You've been criticized of late because you spent 33 years as the head coach here, two as an assistant, and then you go over as a volunteer assistant to an arch rival, North Penn. You're not the modern Judas, are you?
Well, people have referred to me as that, and Benedict Arnold, and but it was tough. Football is a game. The fans follow with a passion. People looked at me as a turncoat. The problem was facing my son. One of the toughest things in my coaching career was walking across the field and seeing the hurt and pain on his face, knowing what goes into a football game, the preparation. That happened, five or six times? When I was out of football, I didn't want anything to do with coaching, but after a year, the battery started to get recharged. I didn't want to come back as a head coach, and I don't know how exactly happened, but the conversation got around to my being an assistant with him, and I thought it would be nice. I thought at CB West, I shouldn't be around in anybody's shadow and let that person do his own thing. So
wouldn't have been fair to any new coach.
It wouldn't have been fair that maybe any success, it would have been, Pettine's in the background pulling the strings. So, and even my son went out, he was criticized for saying, what do you got your dad now as a crutch, and people have told me, what do you want to put your son in this position for? If he has any success, they're going to say, you're the guy that's over there. And actually, I wasn't even a coordinator. I mean, as Mike Carey was my right-hand man, he had Dick Beck, one of my former players. So those two were a great team and ran the show, and I was just an assistant and had my little group. But without the pressure and the hassle and the peripheral headaches, I had a great time. I was just with pure teaching. I showed up, I had my group, and it was a tough year. Now, the one thing, we were preseason ranked number one in the state, and maybe because I was on the staff and it was unfortunate to have that monkey on their back, we lost a couple games. Now, of course, North Penn beat West, which I took a beating on again. And
how did you feel about being in that game?
It was just as tough as when I coached against Michael, is walking across the field to see those West kids I had as 10th graders. You know, the guys with the black and gold uniforms, to see Randy Cuthbert, Joe Schmidt, Joe Holman, and the other guys I respect and love, to see the dejection and the disappointment. It was a situation I didn't want to be in, but unfortunately, the teams are in the same league. So,
you're going to continue to coach with your son?
If my son stays there. If he leaves, maybe West will want to take me back as a consultant or something.
I don't think they ever want to lose you, at least on some
basis. And I want to say, I stayed very close with Randy and the other coaches, and I was there, exchanging scouting reports. And what my answer to was, I don't have a problem with it. If the people that are affected the most, Randy Cuthbert and his staff, they say they don't have a problem with it, why should anybody else have a problem with it?
Mike, do you stay in touch with your former players?
Yes. Sometimes reunions, weddings, golf outings. We exchange a lot of the players' Christmas cards. Every now and then, I'll get calls, and I got a recent call from Tim Donovan, one of the class players we had, played at Holy Cross, had a great career. And he became head coach at Conestoga and principal. And it's quite an accomplishment. He was in the business world for a couple of years, but he wanted to thank me for the part I had in his changing careers and getting into education. And I mean, that's an example of the type of thing that's really gratifying when you have individuals like that that do so well in the professional world. And you can always say, hey, that's a representative and a product of a CB West football program.
Mike, we as a nation experience a horrendous day on 9/11. And one of the things that a number of people think is that we changed the definition of hero.
Right.
That hero used to be an athlete or athletes.
Right.
And now they're policemen, firemen,
right.
Military.
Right.
How do you reflect on that?
Well, I never liked the fact that athletes were put up on a pedestal. The guys I played with in college who went on the pro ball, there was just a fine difference between their talents and being in the right place at the right time and maybe someone who was injured or had a little less talent or didn't have a real specialized talent, like I say, as a kicker or a quarterback. And when you take a look at these athletes and how much they're paid and how much they're looked up to, and certainly you have to admire what they've done, and many of them play with courage and overcome adversity. But it's nothing in comparison to what a fireman does or a policeman or someone in the armed services that puts his or her life on the line every day. And the sacrifice that they might make would be the ultimate, to give up their life. And, I'm just as proud of anything I've ever done as with my brother, as a Vietnam vet, and he's a police chief of Plymouth Township and has 50-some people. He's a member of a SWAT team, and he's been to school and trained at Quantico for all the hazardous things he's gotten into. So these are people that I've always admired, and I'm glad that now there's a renewed recognition of what we owe our firemen, policemen, and service people and other people in that line.
So out of that tragedy, maybe we've had the entire society redefine hero and have a real learning experience.
Absolutely. And, it pleases me to see at a lot of these college and professional games that acknowledgement and recognition, and that the guests of the game are some of the firemen from New York and the policemen and servicemen, and, moments of silence are taken to recognize the real heroes. And I know the NFL has a program to acknowledge that and the way it should be.
This interview has certainly been a lot of fun for me, and I thoroughly enjoyed being with you.
Fun for me also. Thank
Great.
You.
My pleasure.
Bill.